Let me mute it as soon as it starts. This is the call for yesterday's meeting. So I will share the link with you right now. Anyone who didn't attend yesterday's call can get the information and everything from there. Okay. So something else that I thought you should have is this article. So at least you can go through it. You can see, you can try getting something from it. It is very helpful. I have tried to summarize and I can say to summarize and paraphrase everything that we'll be covering today in one article. It is 7 minutes long, read long. So you can just in 15 minutes time, we can double the time and one bonus for being distracted whenever you're reading. So this is the article. Feel free, if you want to ask any question in the article, you can ask. Then we'll be practicing and coding from this part. So you'll be using this Google Collabs to practice. Any question? Kaidri, as soon as you join, make sure that you're on mute so that you don't distract us. I was saying we'll be going through this article. We'll be going through all these materials and we will go through across this. It is distracting me. And we'll code, we'll do some practice here. And also I'll show you how to run your programs on, how to run your program using the available environments that are there, like VS Code, how to use VS Code to run your program. How can you use a Sublime Text Editor to run your program? So that are some of the things that we'll be covering today in the program. So let's get started with what is Python. So I think, as you all know, what is Python? Python is a high-level programming language. It was created between 1991. I won't be covering this basic information, but we know Python programs have an extension. So whenever you create a Python program, you give it an extension of PY, that is for to show that it is a Python program. But if you're using an Acoda environment and you're using Jupyter Notebooks, your extension should be .ipynb. That is for Interactive Python Notebook. Okay, so ipynb means Interactive Python Notebook. This is when you're using Google Collabs, or also in a case that you're using Jupyter Notebook in Anaconda. So whenever you want to execute or learn a file that is created in a text editor or an environment, you use this method. Python, maybe you're using Python 3, you say Python 3, then the file name, let's assume you created a Python file that is called app.py.py, then you execute. When you hit enter in the terminal, or in the terminal for the Windows and Mac users, it will execute. For those who are using Windows, they can use CMD, they can use PowerShell, or install a third party utility for executing these commands. So you can just go. They are common utility, yeah. They are common, we call them common productivity tools that are there you can use to execute your commands. And we know, as you all know, defining blocks of code in other programming language, we use the curly braces, opening and closing curly braces to show that this is a block of code. But when you come to Python, we don't use block of codes. Like if I was straight up a JavaScript code, maybe it's a simple function in JavaScript. I would write it like this. Let me show you so that we can be together there. Yeah, I can execute it in any environment, or I can even use here, I would delete. So for JavaScript, don't pay attention to the things that I'm typing, just pay attention to the curly braces that will be there. So assume you want to create a function, you'll create a function like that. Then after having this, you will write like this. I made an error, I executed the cell. So after doing like that, I can press like that. Now you see there is this curly brace and this another one to show that you are inside a block of code. Okay, I missed someone here, function name. So this is how you create a function in JavaScript. You use function keyword, then name of your function, then the parentheses, and you open the curly braces. Now, inside the curly braces, here is where you define your block of code. But when you come to Python, we use indentation. And after indentation, we don't use function, we use the def keyword. So the thing I wanted to bring into attention is that in Python, we don't use the curly braces to define the block of code. So I can comment this, it doesn't have meaning there. So that is all about saying Python uses, we call it white space or indentation to define block of code. We don't use curly braces. Another thing about Python, we call them the tailing semicolons, or the head of line semicolons are optional and usually are not used in Python. I don't know how many times you have used them. I was here. I don't know how many times maybe you're using any Python library and maybe wanting to import math, or maybe import from Flask, you're using Flask, import Flask. I don't know if you know you can have this semicolon there at the end, but we don't use it. Having that semicolon doesn't cause any error, but we usually ignore it in Python. So you have to know the tailing semicolon is optional in Python. And Python has become the best solution in many domains, from web application, data analysis, data science, machine learning, and other fields that you can apply. So before I discuss the features that are here, I wanted to discuss that Python, being a programming language, it supports four different programming techniques. So yeah, I can call them techniques. So the first technique that we have, I will be adding the sketch note here at the head of this. It is support, the first one is object oriented. We all know about object oriented. So Python supports the four available programming techniques. You can use object oriented, OOP. Then after using object oriented in Python, you can decide to use another process, procedural programming, the traditional way of coding. Oriented, or we can call it is procedure oriented. Another four technique that you can use in Python is functional. You can use ordinary functions and objects in Python. Oriented. This another one is object oriented. Python object oriented. Oriented, being object-oriented, procedure-oriented, there is one which is remaining. Oh, imperative. It also supports imperative. It supports imperative. Or you can say it is imperative-oriented. So we can use any technique that you are sure of that you want to use. I think I made an error. This is a hit. Yeah, you can use any technique that you have that you feel like you should use with Python. So I will highlight everything and change the font size so that it can be visible. So these are the techniques that we have that we can use in Python. Someone is texting. Yeah, the one who is raising your hand, you can ask your question, please.
Hello, I wanted maybe why you can define imperative, because I've come across the functional, procedural, and object oriented, but imperative, then you can maybe you can try and find them for.
I will share the link. You can go to look at it later. This is the definition of imperative approaches, where you specify the step that the computer must take to accomplish a goal. Okay? Like, you are writing the steps, so I will share the link, you go to look at it. But it is well explained here in the highlighted part. You as a developer, what you do, you don't create functions. You just define the steps that a computer must take to complete a specific task. Your question answered?
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. Any other question we have? Sorry. Do you have any other question? Okay, let's go on. I think this will be helpful for anyone who wants to learn about it. So that's all about that. Then we have specific features that Python supports us with. Simplicity, like it helps you to think less of the syntax of the language and write more of the logic of the code. So that is why we have the, that is why Python maybe it's preferred a lot. It has been discussed as the most popular programming language, maybe after JavaScript. They are competing with JavaScript. They are too simple. Even JavaScript is simple. So basically, you have to know, you don't have to worry about coding syntax, how you structure something after something else. If you just went through the, okay, I should ask this. Maybe you went through the materials that I shared yesterday. Have you gone through the materials that I shared about the Pepate rules that we have? Have you went through the cheat sheet? Actually, that will be the, that will be part of the blog that you write this month, this week. So another thing, Python is open source. You don't have to pay for anything. You just use it for free. Most of the materials that, most of the frameworks that we have is are free. FastAPI is free, Django is free, Flask is free. Compared to other languages, there is a other powerful language that is used, especially in the field of data science and machine learning, MATLAB. The only problem with MATLAB by MathWork, MATLAB was produced by MathWork, it is not open source, so you have to pay or have a cracked at least software so that you can be able to use it. So that makes it less important or less useful compared to Python, because you, if there is something free to use, as so, okay, human being, I'll be inclusive there. We like free things. We like, if it is like it solves the same error, the same problem, and it is free, we should consider that which is free. Then another thing, portability about the code. Python code can be shared in any platform. I would like to explain that if you're using, if you're using, maybe let's assume you're using Windows, another one is using Mac, another one is using Lapsberry, you can share that code. If I'm using Mac, I can write it, share to someone who is using Windows. Another thing that I can say about it is being extensible and embeddable. Like, if you have worked with maybe machine learning project, the advanced levels, and maybe you want to integrate a very fast computer vision program. I prefer working with C++ for computer vision program. And you meet, it is very easy to embed the code that I have in C++ with Python very easily without any problem. Those will enroll for the final bootcamp that will happen maybe two months from now. The old data science bootcamp, not for the web development, but those who enroll for the data science bootcamp will see this in practice, like how you'll be creating the programs to detect maybe computer vision. And that is where you'll be making use of the, you'll be making use of the C++ and Python at the same time. Then it is an interpreted language. Huge amount of libraries are available, both for data science. Also, there is one I left out, web development. For desktop applications, you can use the available resources, available framework and libraries that are there. Then it is object-oriented, object orientation. I won't talk about that anymore. Then we know where Python can be applied. You can apply Python in artificial intelligence. It's yesterday I was talking about to someone about, some people about creating a program that maybe detects a crop disease. It can be able, you can take, you can create a model using Python. You can package it the way you usually package using joblib and pico in Python. Those are Python libraries that we have for packaging Python object, either a function, either a model, anything that you have. Then you call it as an API using any framework that we have. Currently, you can use a very popular library that is called Streamlit. and convert it to a web solution, convert it to a mobile solution, such that someone can take now a photo with this phone. The application can interpret the crop disease that we have. It can prescribe the medication that all any chemicals that we can apply. If we don't want to use chemicals, it can also prescribe the organic materials that you can use to combat the crop disease that we have. I think I had that example and I'll be sharing it maybe at the head, at the most head of the call. So I'll be sharing the code so that you can go and see how Python was used in such an example. There are a lot of examples that you can use. Desktop application you can build. Automation, those who attended the onboarding session I had from Timothy, who was an automation engineer at, I don't even remember. Web development, in the third week, we'll be seeing this, how to build application using FastAPI and Flask. Data logging, exploration of data and data visualization. There are available libraries and frameworks that are there that we can use in Python and be able to, and be in a position to visualize and make insight from data. Also, remember the article, there is another article I shared. I didn't share in the group, but it was about how to use data analysis. Maybe I can come here. So I think this is the article here. So this is where Python was used. This is a little example of where Python was applied now to do data analysis. And you can make insight. Now, this is exploratory data analysis of the Titanic data set of the accidents that occurred on the, it was called Titanic boat or what? Ship, sorry. So you can see it's just Python. You're defining library, a variable in Python. Then here you're using a method. There you'll be using print today. So this is the whole process. And you can be able to see, like from here, where do we have missing data? Where do we have missing data using Python? We can be able to predict where did people survive, in which class were these people, the passengers class. So those are some of the examples that we can, we'll be looking at the head of the bootcamp so that you can be able to create your final project. I have shared about that I was talking about now installing Python. Those who attended the today's call, they saw how to, I think we looked at how to install Python, we looked at how to install GitHub, we looked at how to set up VS Code. Yeah, I talked about VS Code. I also talked about the VS Sublime Text Editor. You can use any of your choice. Then now let's start creating Hello World. Like someone said, he works at Artisan, big platform, it has a community maybe in Nairobi also. It is an engineering manager. They said, if you can write Hello World, you can change the world. So let's look at how can we create now a Hello World program using Python. So usually you start by creating a folder, and you're creating a folder that you'll be storing your data, all your files. Like I have this file, maybe I'm creating this application. So I start from scratch, creating a folder. Inside this folder, I create a file, and inside this file, there is where I create the code that I want. Now, to create a Hello World program in Python, we use the print method, okay? And the print method is a function that displays a message on the screen. In our case, it will show Hello World. So let's try to do that. How can we create Hello World program? Can you see all enlarge the size? Yeah, together. Just someone confirm.
Yes, you can see. Yeah, but you can increase the
I think that's okay now. So I will start by, maybe I can navigate to my desktop. CD. Then, whenever you're using terminal to navigate, remember tab is a shortcut. So whenever I start writing desktop and I click tab, it will just take me there where I want. Then I can make a directory called example like that, then I can enter. And if you look at my FI list, of which, yeah, it has this folder that I have created. So I can navigate to that folder using the same technique, and I'm there. Now, I said after navigating to that folder that you want to use, you start by doing what? You start by creating now a file. I will touch then app.py. Now, if I list, I'm expecting to see a app.py file there. How do I open this? Now, there is one thing that I have not done. I've not configured my VS Code to work with the code. If I load code, if I have configured and I load code here, then period sign like that, I will expect it to open, but I have not configured it. So I will just use drag and drop. And you can see my file is here. I will increase the font size so that it can be there. One thing that we talked about, it has come automatically. Whenever you are working with Python in VS Code, please make sure that you install this extension. It is very important. So after that, now I will create the print method. Then I will call up, maybe I can say our first sample. Oh, that is how you create it. So after creating it, you save your file. After saving your file, you can open the terminal from this part of VS Code, or you can come to your terminal. You can clear. Then after clearing, you write Python to check the version of Python installed. You can do this. Don't do this every time that you're learning your code. Like, I just wanted to check the version of Python that I have. So I learn Python 3 hyphen hyphen version. So after that, you can see it is telling me I have version 3.9. And someone asked me a question and they recommended you install Python 3.6 or 3.8. Please don't rush installing Python 3.10, please. So let's go on. After that, now you want to run the file. I've seen I have Python 3. So I will write Python 3. After that, I will write the name of my file, which is app.py. So that is how you execute the code. You can see our first example has been printed. There is another way of printing it instead of creating files. If maybe you want to work with the databases, whenever you're doing the backend development, or maybe you want to check the status of the server, how operations are going on, or you want to do maybe automation, a lot of automation, you learn the code, you write the code in a file, then you automate it after a specific maybe instance or event has occurred. But you can write Python 3 and you'll be given this environment. Now, when you paste something there and run enter, you can see it will be printed there. That is the first. The first is creating a file and running it in the terminal, or you can use the VS Code terminal. The second way is to open the interactive shell using Python, and you can have Python 3 if you're using Mac or Linux. I like Python 3 to specify exactly you don't want. You know, if you're using Mac or Linux or Ubuntu or anything, not Windows, anything else apart from Windows, the operating system comes installed with Python 2. If I quit this, if I quit and write Python, then version, I didn't install Python 2.7, it comes pre-installed like in the operating system. That is why we specify you use 3 after the Python 3. So be keen so that you can't execute something that is wrong. So we are good up to there. You have seen how to write the program. Another thing, there is an interactive environment that exists in the cloud. It is called Google Colabs. This, you can use it to create any Python program that you want. You can come, as I showed yesterday, I think I demonstrated this yesterday. And after coming here, you can write to Google Colabs. You can add research because it is under research domain of the, yeah. Then you can click, this is very bad. You can click a new notebook. It will refresh and open a new notebook. Then you can write your interactive Python program here, print. And if you want hello world, and when I learn this, it is connecting initializing because I'm using my LAM and my laptop is a bit slow. So you can see it has printed hello world. There is another instance of you want Jesus, you want to get the input from the user. So you use the input method. I'm just showing it as another hello world example. There is a text. Yeah, ask your question, Brian. There is no question. Oh, I think Kaidre. This is what I'm trying to say. If you have a question, don't print it in the chat. Ask it, unmute yourself, say please, then you can go on asking. So that, you know, I'm not looking at the chats in the conversation, and I've seen you have been chatting and I have not opened it. So please make sure that if you have a question, unmute yourself and ask your question. Otherwise, I won't be able to see it and I'll just go on. Someone has asked, how has we printed the output? The first thing I said, you come in your terminal. You navigate to where you want, then you create the file that you want. For my case, I'm using terminal, so I can use touch. Then example two, I can use one.py and I run it. If I print, I expect to see the second file. If I come in my text editor, I'm expecting to see another file. And maybe I wanted the user to print their name. So I can have name is equals to, then use the print method. Not print, sorry, the input. We use the input method whenever you want to ask the user for some input. Then you can tell them, enter your name, please. So I can save this, control save. If I come to my terminal, maybe and I want to run the second file, I said I know the name of my file. It is called ex1.py. So you write Python 3. After that, you print the name of the file that you have. Like it is x1.py. And you can see it is asking me for my name. I will say Lux or unknown or you, just anything. Then you can see it has terminated. So if I wanted to print the result now, I can come here and print my variable name. And I will save it. And I will execute it again. Python 3, followed by my name. My name, the file of my name. Like the name of my file, sorry for that. Now, if I ask for my name, I say you. Then you can see it is printing you. So, or you can add some functionality here using F string. Then you can say my name, your name is, name is. Then you can do the interpolation here. Then you can close it there and you can close there again. Then you can save, command save. If I run now, what I'm expecting to see, yeah, I add that. If I execute the file, you can see it is asking me for my name. If I print maybe Aaron, you can see it is printing your name as Aaron. Someone has a question, just ask, please. It's like, yes, not, it's, okay, he is complaining about not seeing. So I think you can refresh your browser. I was almost to say your server. So we have seen a trace how to work with it. Now, we have looked at how to execute the file. I hope we are all there. There's something that is called comment in Python. Comment, they help, comment is a text in a program code. Like we can see it is a code, text in program code. It helps us to document whatever you're doing. But please don't, make sure that you don't overdo it. Like there is that one person who will come here and try to say, I defined a name and asked for the input, defined a variable name. Then you come here, I printed it out. It becomes so boring, like you are doing something like, if your code doesn't explain itself, then there is something totally wrong with your development skills. But it's okay. I'm not a gatekeeper. Just do it the way you do, as far as it works. But if you are doing with a team, please make sure that you don't make someone's life very hard. Please try to make sure that if you are writing Python code, can't you use 30 minutes to go over the Pepeat rules so that your code looks like anyone else's code? So that is just I won't be giving a speech again. Sorry. So I was saying don't overdo it. So let's look at what is comment. Comment are those text in Python. We can call them script or any other file that you can find some text. But whenever the code is executed, they are not like executed. You can't see it in the, if they, I'm building a web application in Flask and I comment my text out, whenever the user looks at that code, maybe I was creating a Flask application and I come here, this is not the comment in Python, it is the comment in Flask. Now, if I try to have this text, hello, then it means that this text won't be executed. If I open the code to view the code, the way you do view source code, then this part of the text won't be available. But if you look it from the server side, if you're looking at the source code from the server side, you'll be able to see this code, but it won't be executed on your UI. So that is what you're talking about when I'm saying another file. However, it is seen when viewing the source code. The developer who created the source code knows this comment is there, it exists. And whenever the use of the application is using the application, it is not executed. We have two types of comment in Python. One is not comment, even if we refer to it as comment. In Python, this is how you comment, single line, like this. If I wanted to comment the whole file, I would use triple quotes. It is not treated as comment. Note that if you are running your code in interactive Python environment, this code will be executed. But if you're learning it somewhere like here, if I save this, let me save this and try to execute the file again. Let me clear. If I execute this code, you can see. Nothing is printed, but we have some code there because they are commented out. So multiple line comment in Python, you can use double or single quote, but they should be three times, 1, 2, 2, like that. Then you come here, you have them at the end. That is how you do multi-line comment in Python. If you are doing single line comment, do it like that. Something else I have to mention, talking about blocks of code, but you mention it when we reach to functions. That is all about comments. Then we have operators that are there in Python. If you want to perform an operation in Python, we have the arithmetic operations. So I'll be talking about, we can talk about operators before variables, it's okay. Operators, they help you to do any mathematical operation. Only the arithmetic operators. You know, I saw this question that was asked in an interview, and I will ask right now, how many operators do you know? Just list some of the operators that you know in any programming language that you know. Someone can mute unmuted try. We said there is no shame in not knowing stuff. We all learn. Just name them. I don't want the list.
Yes,
I just want to give examples.
There is arithmetic operators.
Yeah.
And logical operators.
Yeah, I can see you're in the late track. So there is someone who was asked about operators and he started listing this out in an interview. He said, there is an additional operator. We can do addition, we can do subtraction, we can do multiplication.
Logical operators.
Okay, okay, we have add. Thank you. Mute yourself, please. Okay, thank you. So I was talking about whenever you ask about operators, make sure that you don't name these as the operators. These are the operations that you perform. So we have like the addition, we use the plus, minus for subtraction, asterisk for multiplication. Then we use the forward slash for division. We use two asterisk for exponential like square. We use them. This is the modular sign or the percentage. It shows the remainder. And we use this to show the from division, like how many times is this number divisible by a certain number that is given. Those are the operators that we have. Then before I talk about variables, or I can start with variables. Let's start understanding variables. So just understand variables are used to store information to be referenced and manipulated in a computer program. So if you have that text or you have that data that you want to store somewhere, you store inside variables. And they also provide a way of labeling data with a descriptive name. Like if I want name, if I'm writing a serious program and I want the user to print name, I can't have X there. That is like a weird code. I can't have food where I want the user to have the name there. So make sure that you use the descriptive name to make sure that your code is more readable and understandable. You can look at their sole purpose as to label and store data in a memory. Like it's a memory storage definition, but where you store the data so that you can reference to it later. And after that, there are things that we call keywords. After variables, I don't want to go on before I talk about keywords and identifiers. We have keywords. Keywords, they are special reserved ones, which we have that conveys a special meaning to the compiler. They are ones that you can't use to name your variables. They are ones that you can't use to name your identifiers. They cannot be used as identifiers because they are there for a specific operation or a specific meaning. An example is for, an example is def. These are keywords in Python. We'll look at the list of keywords that we have in Python. So I've talked about identifiers and you might ask me, what are identifiers in Python? So identifiers are names. They are names that are used to identify a variable, a function, a class, or an object. I thought this was simple, so I didn't added or included them in the materials. So we have said identifiers, they are names that are used to identify the variables, to identify the functions, to identify the class, and to identify the object. And we have specific rules that we follow. And these rules helps us to do what? To make sure that the identifiers that we have are valid. The first rule that we have, you can't use... let me open this page just for the sake of fun. So there are rules that we have when defining identifiers. So we start here. We have keywords, special ones that conveys a special meaning or performs a certain specific operation. We can't use to name identifiers. And what are identifiers? We have said identifiers are names that are used to identify variables, to identify functions, to identify class, to identify objects. So we are there. then we have said there are some specific rules that you should follow whenever you are naming your identifiers. The first rule, apart from underscore, you can't use any other special character naming your identifiers. So please, the only allowed special character is the underscore. It is the only special character that is allowed when you're naming your identifiers. You can't have hashtag in the middle of two names. Another thing, you can't have maybe asterisk there. Mute your mic, please. So I've said only underscore is the only special character that we can use naming identifiers. Another thing, keywords cannot be used naming identifiers. I think I talked about that. The other thing, Python keywords are case sensitive. Oh, Python identifiers are case sensitive, sorry. Like, I can't name my favorite food like this. Then I go, when I'm referencing it to print out here, I'm using F with uppercase letter. I can use this case, which is here. If I tried to use name like the way you can see it there, I can't come here and try to reference name with capital N there. That will cause error. It will cause a certain error, and I want to prove to you that by having N with capital A there, then I'll save. If I try to execute this program, you can see the code, you can see the terminal here. If I execute the program and I try to print maybe anything, I expect the error. This is, we get it because N is not defined. You see at something that we call catch, try and catch. Like we try to use exceptions. Try and catch is for JavaScript. We use exceptions and try to make sure that even if this part of program failed, this part that we wanted to be executed, and this part, we can use the exceptions to give us the part that is causing the error and the type of error that we have in the code. So that is, we'll cover it when you're covering error handling in Python. So I was talking about they are case sensitive, identifiers are case sensitive. The first one, the last one is the first character of an identifier. I can't start with a numeric value there. You can see even the environment itself, it's telling me I have some error. So you can't have one name, but you can use it after the first character. So the first character of an identifier always should be, it should be a digit. Like it cannot be a digit. It can be any other character, but it cannot be a digit. It can be even an underscore, but it cannot be a digit. So pay attention to that. So I was talking about having all the rules that we should follow whenever we are naming our identifiers in Python. And you have said what identifiers are and what keywords are. We'll come later to that. We'll look at it here. Then there are other operators that we have in Python. We have the logical, the conditional, and the comparison operator. So we should have at least a 5-minute break or a 2-minute break so that we can interact. We don't like get the flow. So if you have any question up to where we have reached, you can ask the question, then you'll be back. Just you can type anything that you feel like in the chat box. We have one more hour to go. That is why I gave the break. If you have any question, anything that you want to ask, any material that you want sent to you, are doing that right now. Someone is requesting the screen back. That is the code that you expected, that you wanted to share. Also, remember, you can take a screenshot. Sorry, I did the reverse first of what I wanted. You can take a screenshot and share with your friends on Twitter, on LinkedIn, Python Bootcamp Day 1. Hello, let's go on. There is something that we have left in the materials that I had forgotten. The literals, let's look at literals that we have and the types of literals that we have. One is string, so that's come, I can be adding it here. So we have strings. After, I can add it to the most bottom part. Just add literals that we have. Inform others you have exactly like 2 more minutes for the break. So we have string literals. After string literals, we have numeric literals. After numeric literals, we have the Boolean. After the Boolean, we have the special. Literals, but in I should have literal because the special is one. Literals. So I think even from the definition or the values that I've given here, you already know what literals are now. Eight. I hope I'm not on mute. Yeah, you can't use backticks. Someone is talking about backticks. Backticks are for formatting. I think they are abandoned in recent Python update. It is possible to use the terminal, built-in terminal in the VS Code. Yeah, I think I answered that, Martin. Kubona, Martin, I answered your question where I said you can use any environment that you wish to. Then someone is asking about backticks. In backticks in Python 3.6, avoid them. They cause errors. So literals are basic data types. Literals is the value that we have in the data type. Like in this example, the literal now is the, okay, this is a bad example. So I can have age is equals to 30. Now 30 is the literal. If I have name or county, if I have county, I can have it like that. It's equals to maybe Uganda. I made some error here, and I want you to stop using the semicolon at the end. So if you do like that, Uganda is the literal. Okay. If I have maybe val is equals to none, which is the special literal that we have in Python. Now, none is the literal. If I specify the value to be maybe logged in, if it is true, then true is the literal. So I think by now you understand what are literals and what literals really are. Another literal that we talked about is the numeric. Someone is raising his hand. Yeah. We define literals as the data given in a variable or the constant. I can't specifically say a variable because you have constant. Let me ask someone a question. I want a volunteer so we can have a simple conversation as wait for others. Just 1 minute. How do we define constant and how do we define variables in Java, in Python, sorry? Someone to try, give a try. Someone, there is no volunteer to define what is, how do we define Python according to Perpet? How do we define Python and how do we define variables? Another thing that I wanted to, a volunteer, please, 1 minute, please.
Maybe a trial.
Yes, Timothy, try.
Mostly for variables, you use small letters or camel casing, but for constants, you use capital letter for the first. Then the keyword for variables, you can use let or var, but for constants, you start it with const.
Yeah. Anyone else? I saw someone raising his hand. Yeah, you can just unmute yourself and talk if you're in a position.
Okay, on Perpet guide for defining a variable in Python.
Who posted this tweet? You can just go on. Just go on, Greg.
Okay. You, for variables, you use lowercase. And for functions, you can use camel case and classes also. You can, but Perpet mostly.
You said you can use, right?
Yes.
You can use camel case to do it. So just be discreet.
For class names.
They are not names anymore. We said they are
identifiers.
Nice. Now we are together.
Okay, and also you can use snake case. The snake case where you separate, if it's two names, you can separate using an underscore.
Now, let me ask you, have you gone through the materials that I sent on Perpet rules?
No, not at all. I've been busy, yes, but I'm checking them out. Yes.
Will you manage to write the article when you are given?
To write the article?
Mm-hmm.
No, I haven't seen the materials or that.
Okay, you'll share the assignment by tomorrow. I think tomorrow. Another thing about the article that I shared, the resources, just pay attention to it. You can see we are using real examples. Like we are using, like there is a place we are using. Can we validate now an email? Like how can we classify it as a spam or not spam? So at always when you are creating in a program, even if it's a toy program, make sure that you create it in a way that it looks like it's a real program. Like, don't, like, there is something I saw. Okay, there is something we say about machine learning, those who do data science and machine learning. When you're satisfied or when you have classified enough cutted docs, stop classifying now cutted docs, start creating real examples. So the same thing I wanted to say about Python. Please try to specify or to structure your program, even if it's a toy program, in such a way that it looks like it's a real program, like it's an email classification. If you're given something to classify, maybe student grades, to give them a pass or a fail, to calculate even the percentage given some marks, make sure that you structure the code that it looks like whenever given a UI, this program can be logically correct. If it's something to calculate discount, anything that you do, try to make it something that looks very natural, like a real world example. So let me go on sharing. And after I share about literals, I will need a volunteer. You will share his screen. We will guide you how you can push a hello world program on GitHub and how you can pull it back, how you can make changes and push it back on GitHub, and someone else can use that code. So Timothy, be prepared for that. Timothy, I gave you the volunteer, and don't leave. So let me talk about literals that we have in Python. So literals are data given in a variable or a constant. So the exact value that we have there. Now, when I show you a code like, sorry for this, that was terrible. If I show you a code like this, start telling me inch is not a name for a variable. It is an identifier. Start telling me 30 is the literal and it is a numeric literal that we
have. Sorry, can you share this?
Sorry for that again. I even thought I'm sharing whenever I said this is terrible. Sorry. Cancel. Whenever you can see it, confirm. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about literals here. Literals are here. And whatever we have, we are talking about the literals that I was saying. Literals, whenever you are given such a code like this, start telling me age is an identifier, 30 is a literal, country is an identifier, Uganda is a, it is a literal. Whenever you're given maybe print, start telling me print is a method. Don't tell me, start telling me print is a method. Whenever, and tell me print is a keyword. Whenever you're given def add, then now you're trying to add maybe, or you're trying to get the age. Let's use the age. Then we are trying to get X. I won't complicate it very much. I just want something simple like that. So start telling me that def is the keyword. Then age is what? Age is the identifier for that function. And whatever is happening here is a function. And whenever it comes here down, I should have the indentation, white space, to specify what? To specify the block of code. Another thing that you observe, please, as soon as you start, stop mixing tab. When you click tab at once, it does what? It gives you the fourth tab, the spaces, and the other space, the normal space bar. Stop mixing them when you're doing indentation. Another thing about Pepet, who has gone through Pepet? Before I talk about the retros that we have, I conclude on it. Anyone who has gone through Pepet? Okay, so you're joking. I think I gave the materials yesterday. Who has gone through Pepet? Python Enhancement Proposal 8. Also, it's me alone. No one? Okay, Pepet recommends we use one of the two. So I'll leave you to go and look. It either recommends you to use tab or it recommends you to use the spaces. So go and research which one is the best, which one is the favorite, like which one is more reliable. When you mix them, you'll get ahead of the line header. So make sure that you don't mix tab and the spaces whenever you are giving the indentation. Indentation normally is four spaces. When you use tab, it gives you the four spaces at once. When you use the space bar, you'll use it four times to give the exact space. When you mix them, imagine you are writing a 3-day line of code program, and maybe you have coded in line 3, maybe in line 280, maybe feature 2 upper katikati. It has hidden itself somewhere inside there. So you have started now mixing the tab and spaces such that whenever you learn line 3 at 12, you meet there is an error which you can't get. So make sure that whenever you are using the indentation, you use consistent indentation. Literals, we have said it is the data that is given in a variable or a constant. And if I was defining maybe a constant to be none, I would say const with uppercase letters. Or I can just give it any value like val. As soon as you write your code and I'm looking at your code, you know, sometimes we go to look at the frameworks that are given. Sometimes we go to look at the source code. And whenever I look at their code and I meet something like this, I know this is a constant. So we have four types of literals that we have in Python. The first one is string literal, like the one that is here. The second one, the one that is here. The second one is numeric. And for the numeric values, we have two types of numeric values, not two actually, they are four. We have the integer, the positive or negative numbers without a fraction or exponential, like the one that is here. I could also have a long. A long, it's always have a hell at the end. I won't overfeed you with this. You go and look at long, look also at float. Complex, also look at the complex. So the complex literal, it has an imaginary and the real value. So go on and look. You might meet someone as defined as pi, or we can call it value. Yeah, value is equals to. Now I can give it as 3.14i. So you might come to me telling me this is wrong, but it is not wrong. This is a value that is called what? It is called, I'm talking about literals. It is numeric literals. Under numeric literals, it is classified under complex values. The second one is Boolean. We have two types of Boolean. The first one is true. We can also have false. And we have one special. Python has only one special. According to Python 3.6, I have not checked the latest. I have not been looking at the documentation that much. But as far as I can remember, Python 3.6 supported only one special literal, and that is none. It specifies that the field that is not created. The field is not created. You remember something that we have in Python, JavaScript. I won't do it. But it specifies, I won't complicate stuff. So it specifies that the field is not defined. So I wanted to look at something else very briefly. Operators, we have like seven operators that we have in Python. We have arithmetic, we have the assignment. I didn't list this because they are not important, that much important, but Kaidre, if you ask in an interview, just remember you have seven operators in Python. We have the arithmetic operators, we have the assignment operators, we have the comparison operators, we have the logic operator, we have the bitwise operators, we have the identity operators, and we have the member operators. So I think some stuffs, okay, which I had offered, I didn't have to list them anywhere. So we'll look at them in depth. I don't know when we can do a makeup. We are on Tuesday, we have up to, yeah. We have a Ask Me Anything session on Thursday. We can extend it to the Python core because it will last like for 1 hour. We can extend it with maybe that your 20 minutes where you look at some stuff that you have left. Bitwise operators is one of the complicated parts there, which I would like you to go and look at it. I won't cover data structures and algorithm right now because of some reasons. We have keywords. We have very many keywords in Python. You have to go and look at them. Some of these, which you can remember, things like continually, things like force, things like finally, things like for, things like input, import, all these are keywords in Python. We can't use this naming of variables. Apart from that, I would think we should mention something about functions and recursive functions. We should also look at the four major data structures that we have in Python. That is the list that we use as. We use list as arrays. Okay? I saw someone asking that. That is why I answered it. We use list as arrays in Python. Another thing that we have is tuple. Okay? A tuple and a list. A tuple is just like a list. Only that you can't do what? A tuple is immutable. Like you can't change their value. After that, we'll look at dictionaries. Dictionaries are key value pairs. We'll look at them if you have time today. Yeah, we have a lot of time. I just wanted to show someone who was complaining. We also look at the control flow. Yeah. So I wanted to show someone who had asked me during break. Timothy. Timothy, I gave you.
Yes.
Share your screen, please.
All right.
Then open your browser. Yeah, create a new repository. Example, you delete it later. You just delete it later. Give it. Okay, let me explain something up to them. Always, when you create the account, a new account in GitHub, you are given now the GitHub. Now you are left with two things. You can install Bash. I understood from the look of things, Timothy is using Ubuntu. For him, you'll be using Bash or the terminal. For you as a Windows user, you'll be required to use what? To use, someone tell me, to use CMD, to use Git Bash, or to use, you can install other utility tools like Commander. It is a terminal that you can install locally in your Windows operating system. So what we can do, Timothy, after yes. Doing it, scroll up to the top. At the most top corner, there is somewhere you can see the addition sign. That is the best place I want you to start. You can see there are two things, new repository or new Gist. If you are discussing as a group, yeah, if you're discussing as a group, do this, click on Gist,
GIST.
Yeah, I think GIST has a starting point when you're discussing something as a group. And maybe you want to discuss how do you name an identifier. So write that ero.md. In the coding part, that one is okay. It's okay there. So there you can write any valid markdown, like naming a constant, write naming a constant. You can use the three hashtag to show that this is an heading. Is that heading? Three hashtag. Then space, then you can write naming a variable. Then on the top, you can click enter like twice. This is creating a GIST. A GIST you can use to interact and share anything. Use the three backticks. Specify the language that you are using. Click enter like three times. Go back in line four. Then write how do you define a variable in Python. Use lowercase letters. Then after that you close. No, I wanted you to define an example variable. It may be hello or name is equals to Timothy. You're using JavaScript syntax. Name is equals to, in Perpetu it says always salaud your operators. That is an assignment operator that you have used to them. Salaud your operator with the spaces. Nice. So at the bottom of that line, enter. Cross your ticks. Then at the bottom there, just click enter again. Then you use the three backticks. Oh, sorry, the three hashtag to show the heading. Sorry. Three hashtag. Ask a question. How do we? Now, that is how sometimes we define how we talk about, if you have a specific question about a framework, that is the best way to ask. How do we define constants in Python? Question mark. Yeah, save it. Create as a public, create secret GIST. Click on the, okay, how can I, yeah. There is, yeah, create a public GIST.
Secret public GIST.
I'll create now. Copy the URL and share it in the group. I want someone else to be replying to it. We'll look at it later. That is how you can be interacting. Now, you can see right somewhere where we have the right, someone can print something, can share their detail, their ideas there. That is how we can work with GIST. So you can try to answer so that we can see how it will happen. Anyone who answering the question? Then, Timothy, as you wait, maybe you can go on, just leave it. Someone will reply maybe. Create a new repository. We'll come back later to that.
Oops. I'm in GIST.
You're in GIST. Now you can either go to your profile directory, then come back. Your profile. Then create a new repository using the addition sign again. Using the addition sign. You're still in the GIST.
Yeah.
Create a new repository. So try to be very fast so that we have at least 30 minutes to discuss content. So yeah. Yeah. Then after creating your, yeah, make it public, and create repository. That is how you create a repository normally in Python. Create. After creating, you are given the commands to run. So Timothy, I want you to go in your desktop, flash using terminal, create a folder, create a file, create a hello world program.
Directory and I'll call it hello world.
Mix the command. I'm pressed to mix the command to have at least two commands so that you can speed them up. Yeah, I think I said you can do like three commands in one line. Touch and open in VS Code. Touchup.py. I hope you are following. You're just creating a normal file, py. Nice, enter. Then navigate, open it in the VS Code. Yeah. It will fire up VS Code. Uh-huh. Then you can open your app.py, hoping you have activated the, just define a variable. You're using JavaScript syntax again, Timothy. That is how you define a variable in Python. Then after doing that, save it, push it in GitHub very fast. Now, how do we push it on GitHub? Use the commands that we are given.
The first command is git init.
Yeah, so start there to initialize the repository.
So you can even use this terminal, VS Code scam. What terminal is a git init?
Uh-huh. After doing that, you move to the next step.
Then after that, you add the remote origin.
Yeah. You're adding origin before you even add the files you hand the readme.
You git add.
Git add.
Let me then create the nini.
It is there. Just
read me.
There is a readme. Oh, there is no need of a readme file. Just git add. That is how you do it. Git add. Then to add all files that are there, you use the period sign. If there is a file that you don't want to push, you use the dot git ignore file. So you can create dot git ignore whenever you don't want to push some file, and specify the name of those files on git. This is the, you can take a crash course on git, enter. Yeah, then after that, you add the commit. And there is a way I will leave you to research. There is a way of adding the git and committing the same time with one command. Message. So add the origin. Now you can go there and copy everything and paste. I want to explain the code that is there. Now you have the, then you create the branch, the main branch that you'll be working with. Then you add the origin. After adding the origin, just go on. I hope everyone is following and you can refer to the recording later. After that, move to the next part. You have created a branch. Now you're adding an origin to connect your terminal with the cloud repository that we created. Copy. Now, the origin, adding the remote add origin, it is connecting your terminal now with the cloud, your folder that you have locally with the cloud repository that is there. Then do the last thing, git push. Sometimes you have to understand these steps the way they are. Instead of adding git readme, if you don't, you want everything using git add hyphen o. There is a way of adding files and committing at the same time. I'm leaving you to go and research on that. So Timothy, go in your browser and refresh. Now you can see the code. Now I want you to do one more thing. I want you to make changes in that file locally and be able to push it back, the changes. Just open the changes so that you can see the code that is available right now, not there. You can see it's only one variable that it defined. So here, print that variable. You can print it. Print name. After printing the variable, you can move to the next step.
I push it to GitHub.
Push it back to GitHub so that you can see if the changes have been reflected. Please pay attention to what it does. Clear your terminal so that we can have good space. Use clear to clear your terminal. Then now, push it.
It is always to git add, then you put period side to add everything.
You're adding it now to the staging area. After that, you commit. To give others the message, the message that you want to leave to them. One thing that I should mention there, please stop using past tense. There's sometimes you see someone saying handed up.py. The best place to start is, Timothy, you can just go on. The best place to read about how to commit is reading from the creator of GitHub. The time they created this stuff to create what? They created GitHub to track the changes that they are making. To track the changes when they are creating Linux, I think, something like that. So if you open the Linux source code that is available, it has passed a million commits. So you can read their commit just to understand how you should be committing. Now you can see it has loaded, right? Now that is how you push the code back to GitHub. You make changes, now you keep. There is more things like pulling other people's code, making changes. But at least if you can push your code on GitHub, the first project for this week, you'll be able to do it, and I'm satisfied there. You can go online, I'll be sharing the source where you can reference something on how to work with another team, so that next week project that you'll be working with a team, you'll be able to work with it. Timothy, as someone asked a question, open the GitHub source code that is available. Open the Linux code that we have on GitHub, the Linux source code, and try to open the commit. Just search Linux. Linux source code. Yeah, you can ask your question, Emmanuel.
Yeah, my question is, previously I've been using GitHub, like at school. The lecturer created a repository where we had to fork it as a class group, and we were pushing our code there. And personally, I have my GitHub account. So I'm asking, if I create another repository, like when I clone it into my machine, how will I know that I'm pushing to the new repository, not the class repository that I'd previously been using? How will I separate not to push the code to different repositories?
You forked the class code, right?
Yeah, from the class group.
So whenever you want to add to your local repository, that we understand each other, there is something that you should start doing. The first thing that you should start doing is removing the remote origin. Like the origin will be existing right now. Now, whenever you create now, you'll add it from scratch. Unless you want to make contributions to the one that the lecturer has already, then apart from that, if you don't want to do that, you have to remove the origin so that you can be sure you're pushing it to your local repository. Timothy, I don't know. It's a lot of things we are pushing on Timothy. I will just open the Linux code. Linux source code, you can't see it.
This first one?
The English one, yeah. Not the Chinese or any other version. Now, open the commit. Oh, these are not the, this is not the right one. Just open the commit, I think. The Linux source code should have a million plus commits. Let me try to get it for you.
Just send me the link I open.
It is in the creators page. I think I've already sent it. What did you copy? Event. Just a minute. Yeah, it is here. Control X. It is in the chat box. Just get it from there. This is the best place where you can start reading about how to commit. Open the commits. You can see how many commits they have.
Shit.
So you can look at how they committed. They are not using past tense unless someone is misinformed. Yeah, you can see merge tag, like merge, like they are not using the past tense, like I merged something. So make sure that whenever you're writing your commits, are in present tense, like you're telling someone what to do. Like you can see, there is someone who is saying, don't suppress something or fix something. They are not saying I fixed. They are telling you what you should do in your code that I have done in my code. We together up to there. If I have answered all the questions that we have, we'll look on how to create simple functions. We'll talk about parameters. We'll talk about argument. And we'll talk about how to create a tuple, a list, a dictionary, and a set, and their differences, and we'll end the code there. So Timothy, you can stop sharing your screen. Thank you very much. Anyone with a question before you proceed on coding part?
You're welcome.
No one has a question, so.
Sorry, if I can ask, my repo is private. Should I make it public or you will not be viewing? Like, you want to see our repos or what?
We are not interested in seeing your repo. You know, some people ask, let me answer all of it so that I don't sound rude the way I've started the statement. We are not interested in seeing your repo. Whatever you'd be interested in looking at, the project that we give you, make sure that your repo is public.
That okay, is how so I'd be pushing in the same repository, like.
Yeah, the project that we'll give you, please make sure that you track them in the same folder.
Sorry, like in the same folder, like the one I'm using for classwork. That's what I'm asking.
Yeah.
All right.
Make sure that everything is compiled somewhere. Then we also have a great repository here at RAX. Let me share it. It is with Data Scientist Africa group organization. And whatever you try to do there, we try to have the best practices that you can use. You can see my screen, I guess so. If you can see my screen, this is the code that I maintain personally. I maintain this account. We have some open source project that we have here that you can use. I did some mistake somewhere. So I wanted to share this, but this is not what I want. I went there to share. There is this repo, you can see. This is the account that we use. This is the page that we are trying to open source. Now the idea about this program, it is a Python login and sign up system, where we want to make a PWA application, where whenever you want to start creating an app, there are some files that we call setup file in Python. I hope you have seen it several times. There is a file that we call, today I have several errors. There is a setup.py file creating Python package. So we want to create such that whenever you run this command, maybe pip install lux, you install an application like the way we do and install Django, but this now will be a login system. Whatever it will offer you is a login page, a sign up page, and a landing page at least, and a blog page. And we want it to be a progressive web application. So so far we have several contributors. I'm one of the person who started it, and we have two other contributors. If you have an idea about it, you can share or you can look at it. It will help you to learn. But that's not why I came here. You can also give it a star if you're interested. You want to make it like usable, something that is adaptable to the environment. I came here to share about something here. This is how to write clean code in Python. So that is with this organization here. Yeah, how to write clean code in Python, like how you should structure your code. I didn't push. When did I push that code? Jesus. What was the last commit I made? Last commit. Jesus, I didn't push that. But I think it is available somewhere here. I have that feeling. Introduction to Python, something like that. Yeah, it's here. Didn't, how to write clean code in Python. And this is the repository that you can check all the progress that you'll be working on, the materials, the recording. You can get the links from this repository. By the way, I didn't talk about it. This is the repository that we are working to make sure that it has all the content that we have. You can see the material that I referenced to teach the first phase. You can see the yesterday's recording here. You can see the material. Now, today's recording will be here, and the science will be here, and any other material that you have used. So you can use this repository for that purpose. On it, I added some tips here. You know someone who has written clean code. He is called Uncle Bob's. So he wrote this book, but it was not originally written in Python. So this is a version of it. And we are trying to write now the Python version of it. Now it is here, you can look at it, how to define your variables, how to make sure that your code is clean. So that's all I wanted to talk about before we move on. So what brought me there is whenever I wanted to explain to someone that it is very, I am using two sessions here, so I have to end one. So it is very important to use only one. It is very important to use only one repo for all the projects that you do here. Also, remember to document them very well. So I wanted to talk about several data structures that we have in Python. I'll give a brief definition of what data structures I think are. But data structures are, maybe we can call them a specialized format for organizing and storing data. So they are specialized, and they have a way of working. I want to go deep in it, but I'll talk about lists, I'll talk about tuples, I'll talk about dictionaries and sets. Then we can call it a day because we have exactly 15 minutes from now. We should be ending, and I don't want to take even 1 minute from you. So let's start by creating lists. And lists, by definition, they are ordered collection of items. So they appear in an ordered way. Their order matters. And how do you define it? You can define it in two ways. The first one, you can use the square bracket. So you start by naming your identifiers. You can call it food. After calling it food, or you can call it countries. Let me use something. Something that I know about countries. Then we want to track we want to keep the list of countries that we have for the student to enroll for the bootcamp. So we use the square bracket. The other way of defining a list in Python, this is a list I'm talking about. The second way of defining a list in Python is using this method list like that. So if I have Kenya here, these are strings, so I will use them in quotes. Kenya. Kenya, I have Uganda. After Uganda, maybe I have Rwanda. I won't add another country. The list. Rwanda. Then it is the same as having all these countries here. So that is how you define a list in Python. And if I run it, maybe I can call it country one. If I try now to print this value, copy, I can try to print it here. Control V, so that you can see what will be printed out. It will take some time to connect. This is my row column. I don't initializing. So yeah, you can see it's connecting. Let's see if I have an error. Got an expected argument. List countries. Countries. Rwanda. Oh yeah. Yeah, so you have the problem. Yeah, I can comment this out. I can try to run it. Yeah, now you can see the countries here. There are things you can do with the list. You can try to reference something that is in the list. Like if I wanted to reference something, but know that lists are ordered from zero. So Kenya is in the index zero. So if I want to reference Kenya, I will write countries. Sorry for that. I will write countries, then I will use the square bracket zero. I want to reference the first element in my list. And maybe I want to change it now to Nigeria. NG. So if I run it and I try to print out the countries here now, you can see the first element has been changed and from Kenya to NG for Nigeria. Then we can do operations like appending. Appending is adding a value, and we can also remove. Like if now I wanted to remove Uganda, you could also use dot remove. Let's add something and remove another thing. Let's try to add Ghana. So from my country, I'll add dot append. So append is the method that we use in lists to add values. So I can have Ghana here. Then I can try to print countries and I can run it to see the output. Now you can see it has added value. Like it is behaving like a list that we have in other programming language. And if we want to remove, we can specify whatever you want to remove, remove. And you want to remove NG now. And we can learn it. Sorry. I did some errors here, magic. And we are removing from what? We are removing from this dot, this remove. And yeah. Hey. We are removing. Then you can tell I'm running to use my operating system. We can remove Ghana again. Then we can try to print. We can make it Ghana and we can learn it. You can see I've removed. So to change the value, you use the square bracket, or to reference, use the square bracket. Then you print it. To append or to add a value, you use the append method. And to remove, you use the remove method. That is how you assess values and operate with the list. List values can be changed. If we are working with the tuples, we would only change. I will copy my value so that I don't stay here for long. Control copy. Then I'll come here and start talking about tuples somewhere here. Okay. Let's talk about tuples. Someone is raising his hand. Okay, yeah, sorry. I can do that if you want, but I found it. I can change the runtime. Yeah, I saved. So I can come here. This is printing. So tuples, the only difference they have is you use this. And the only difference that we have between tuples and lists is how you define them. Number two, you can change the value of tuples. Or you can't change the values of tuples, so they are immutable, but you can change the values of a list. So list is mutable. Tuple are immutable. You define them like that. To delete the whole tuple that I have there, let me try to print it. I won't run more methods. We have tuple there. We sent identifiers are case sensitive. Now you can see I used lowercase c at the field. Now you can see my tuple there. If I try to delete everything, I will only write there. There, then count. And now if I run this and I try to reference count, I expect to see an error. Yeah, we can just add here and we can have count. You have to get an error. Yeah. The error that we should get is that count is not defined because we deleted it completely. So that is how you work with lists. That is how you work with tuples. Let's look at dictionaries. Dictionaries, we use the parentheses and they are key value pairs. So I can talk about them briefly. Dictionaries are key value pairs. Like maybe you want to define user profile. So you can say profile. Then they are key value pair, as I have said. So dictionaries are unordered. First thing that is you should know is that dictionaries are unordered collection of items that consist of unique key value pair. You can't repeat a key, you can't repeat a key, but you can repeat a value. So these values should be unique. And you have to know two things. It consists of key value pairs and it is unordered. And we use the parentheses to name it. Now I should like to define, to explain something. Maybe I start talking about Aaron. And when I'm talking about Aaron, I want to give specific details about him. So I can have his name here. And after giving name, I can specify his code Aaron. And after Aaron, I can separate with comma. Then I can have his age. And this age is turning maybe 2 right now. 2. Now you can see it's not organized in any order. And they are separated with a comma. So this is the key. This is the value. The way you are defining identifier and delete rows. Now in dictionaries, someone said something. Chris, ask your question.
Hello, I was asking, do we still put the idiom of the key in the name, the semicolon?
Not necessarily. You're talking about removing this here and trying to run it. Let it work, everyone. Oh, you see, it is treated as a variable, so it's not defined, so you have to. Sometimes in JavaScript, I know it doesn't work. When you're creating objects in JavaScript, you don't necessarily need to put them in quotes. That is why it might be confusing sometimes. But you, in Python, you have to do, because it will be treated otherwise as a variable or an identifier that was not defined. So that is how you define it. And if I want to print it, I can call Aaron and try to run it. You can see it has printed the values here. So I can move to the next part. You have seen the values, it has printed. So something that you can do about it, you can print, you can update. When updating, you use the curly braces. Like I would like to say, like Aaron.update, if I want to add something in my profile maybe, then that is a method. And whatever I wanted to update maybe is, I can say, career, I can say maybe a farmer. doing that now, when I run this at Koharun, if I run this, I'm expecting to see something was added, right? You can see it was added. So that is how you update values. You can also delete. Delete in delete.me. That is how you delete. Then talking about set, set a place I keep, that is how you define my set. My set, I'm running on time, is equals to, yeah, like that. Then you have one like that. Your values like that. The beautiful thing with set, it only print values once. It doesn't repeat. So that is what a set maybe is. You can say it's a list of elements. It is an not ordered, but it doesn't repeat values. Like you have maybe data that was given and you want to identify uniquely which type, which values appear in the data that was given. You can convert it to a set such that any repeated data is omitted when you're trying to print it out. So that's all about set, dictionary, and list. I'll be touching more about them. And I think I still have your 2 minutes, and I'll talk about defining a function very quickly. Defining a function in Python, use def. Then it should be followed by the identifier. Maybe it's called hand. Then from there, you use the full colon to identify end of the statement there. Then after the end, something that I mentioned to say, statements are terminated using full colon in Python. Then after there, I can write any logic I want. I can say maybe return I just wrote it that way so that I can explain something. Then here, I can have A comma B. Then here I can have B. And here, Jesus. Then here at the end, I can now try to print. I can now try to print the 2 values, and I'm trying to print hand. And in the hand, I'm trying to print 10, 13. So the value that I'm expecting to get here is 40. Let's see if I don't have an error. They're 40, perfect. So there is something that we have in Python. Python functions, you define them using def keyword. Then it should be followed by an identifier, that is the name for the function. Then you can pass parameters here. Then when you're calling now that function, the only way to execute a function is by calling it. We also call it invoking the function. So the only way you can execute a function is by invoking it, and you invoke it by calling. And the values that you pass when you're calling a function are called arguments. Then we have the return statement. Return statement specifies what your function should do. It is the block of code that comes inside there that specifies what should be done. Thank you. Unless you have a question, I will take the rest of your time there. Also, I will ask those who have questions for me specifically, keep texting them on Twitter. I think the only platform that I don't blue tick is Twitter because I'm very active there. So if you have a question for me, just drop it there. I will reply it as soon as I can get. You see, there is no question that was asked that I haven't replied on Twitter, but other platform I take sometimes because I have a lot of conversation going on WhatsApp, so I like taking. If you have a burning question that you want to be solved very fast, just ask me on Twitter, I'll be able to solve it. Another thing someone asked about Lux Academy and asked about something, I think it's appropriate to share that we have something that is called Lux HQ Dev, it is here. So this is a platform, a software, talent as a service. So what we do, we identify the best talent such that when you ask maybe by a hiring manager for some talent, we can be able to give it. Maybe we can be able to recommend the best person for the job. And another thing that we are creating right now is I'm organizing an event for all Africa developers. It is called Africa Developer Conference. that this helps us, it is geared to uniting everyone. Like, we want to bring all engineers together in Africa. We can share. Those are who are working in big organizations like Microsoft, Google, and name them, so that they can come, we can interact and learn from each other. Unless now you have a question for me, I'm done, and I'm sorry for taking 2 minutes from you. Any question? Then let me share these materials. Maybe you can use them later. And also I'll share. You can stop recording the call now. Oh, sorry, not here. Someone has a question. It's okay, it's okay.
Hello.
Yeah, ask your question.
I was asking for Git. You only configure once after you have configured the first time, the other time you don't